Pentecost Sunday. Just as on Pentecost Day, the Spirit descended, giving voice to people to spread the word of the gospel, the Spirit of God has descended on pastors from the South Conference and the Crosse Area Synod as we come together to proclaim the goodness of God and the power of the Holy Spirit by worshiping together, by singing together, by sharing prayers and a sermon together. These pastors, leaders, seminarians, along with our assistant to the bishop, Pastor Libby Howe, will share in this worship for you together. May you know that the Holy Spirit has, the Holy Spirit will, the Holy Spirit is coming and is among us. Thanks be to God. Let us worship together. We begin with our call to worship. Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Tahala Yaruahala.
A wind breathes among us, calling us to gather in the name of the Holy One. Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Ay Rohani Rohia del Tarasha.
Hadikana Espero Santo.
A fire burns within us, calling us to service, calling us to prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Viens, Esprit Saint.
Ben, Espiritu Santo, ben.
A spirit moves around us, calling us to worship as God's holy people. Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Ta'al, Ya Ruh Qudus.
O my command, the Santuan Espiritu.
Holy Spirit, come.
Come. Spirit full of truth, fill our hearts. Come. Spirit of life, change our hearts. Come. Spirit of love, soften our hearts. Come. Spirit of hope, heal our hearts. Come, Spirit of faith, strengthen our hearts. Come, Spirit of God, and move in our hearts.
Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Come, Holy Spirit, come.
Amen.
Hallelujah! He is risen indeed.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning you created us in your image and planted in us well water garden. In the desert you promised pools of water for the parched. And you gave us water from the rock. When we did not know the way, you sent the Good Shepherd to lead us to still waters. At the cross, you watered us from Jesus' wounded side. And on this day, you shower us again with the water of life. We praise you for your steadfast salvation through water for the water in this font, and for all water everywhere. Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Satisfy the thirsty, and give us the life only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. At this time, I invite everyone in your homes to mark yourself or the members of your family. They might want to mark each other with the cross of Christ. So we take some water from this font. You can take water from whatever receptacle you're using at home and dip your thumb into that. And I'm going to use Shelley, and I am going to say, Shelley, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen.
Please join me in the prayer of the day. O God, on this day, you open the hearts of your faithful people by sending into us your Holy Spirit. Direct us by the light of that Spirit that we may have a right judgment in all things and rejoice at all times in your peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our reading for this Pentecost Sunday is from the book of Acts, the second chapter, verses 1 through 21.
When the day of Pentecost had come, the apostles were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came the sound like the rush of a violent wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting.
Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability.
Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each.
Amazed and astonished, they ask, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power.
All were amazed and perplexed, saying to each other, what does this mean? But others sneered and said, they are filled with new wine.
But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, but for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel.
In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh.
And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy.
And your young men shall dream visions.
And your old men shall dream dreams.
Old men shall dream dreams.
Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit and they shall prophesy.
And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist.
The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day.
Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Pentecost is a pivot day in the journey of the church year. We have celebrated Easter. The disciples have seen Jesus ascend into heaven. And today, as they gather in a room, the Holy Spirit descends upon them and gives them language and voice so that they can share this good news of the resurrection of Jesus, this good news of God's grace among us with everyone around them. They'll say, why is it that we hear them speak in languages we understand? It is so that they may understand, that they may know that the goodness of God is for them, that the goodness of God is for you. The forgiveness of sins is for them. The forgiveness of sins is for you. On this Pentecost day, may you know that the Holy Spirit has come. My favorite Pentecost memory happened over 10 years ago now. I was not even yet a seminarian, but I was filling in at my home church in Adams, North Dakota. My good friend, Lynn Hildy, was the reader that Sunday. Lynn, although a grown man, hadn't learned to read as a kid. Well, I stand corrected. He would tell you that he didn't know how to read. And one day he told my grandma that. And she said, Lynn, you can read. I taught you how to read when you were a little boy. You would come out to my farm and I would teach you. Lynn, an amazing man who lived with developmental disabilities his whole life, said, I don't think I can. Well, that day, my grandma began writing a story a day for Lynn. Every day, he would come to her house and she would have a story typed up on her typewriter, sometimes with a picture, and Lynn would sit there with her in her house and read her the story. And then take the story about town and read it at Farmers Union and the cafe and the bank and to anybody else who had ears to listen. Even after my grandma died, we still had stories for Lynn. And he still came for a few more days, got the stories that she had written, read them to my mom and me, took them about town and read them to others. So a few months later, as I was beginning to prepare for Pentecost Sunday, I said to Lynn, I would like you to read in church. Now, Lynn came to church. He was used to lighting the candles. He could tell you that he'd lit the candles 527 times. I bet he's up to over 700 by now. He wasn't so sure at first that he wanted to read in church, but we practiced, and I encouraged him. And the voice that was heard by the power of the Spirit on that Pentecost morning was Lynn Hildy's. Lynn, who had never gone to a traditional school. Lynn, who had learned to read sitting at my grandma's kitchen table. Lynn, who was beloved by our entire community of Adams and yet never quite understood what an impact he made, stood at the lectern of our church and proclaimed the word of God. It was a powerful day. The power of the Holy Spirit gives us voice to be able to live out the promise of God in what we say and how we act, in how we share, in our generosity. May the Holy Spirit empower you to follow Jesus and to do what he has called you to do. I give thanks to God for my friend Lynn. I give thanks to God for you. Come, Holy Spirit, come, and may you be blessed by her presence. Amen.
Our gospel lesson today opens with 120 of Jesus' followers gathered in Jerusalem. Many of these followers, including Jesus' closest disciples and Mary, his mother, had spent years with Jesus. They'd witnessed him interpret scripture and bring healing to people who were sick. They had walked with Jesus, followed as Jesus moved from place to place. Some of the closest followers had even been with Jesus during the Last Supper as he washed their feet, taking on the role of a servant, and then gave them bread and wine, telling them this was his body and blood given for them. Some had watched Jesus undress trial and witnessed his agonizing death on the cross. Those who had followed Jesus, who believed in him, their hope was gone when Jesus died. Jesus was no longer with them. Yet days later, when some of the women went to the tomb, they found it empty. Jesus was not dead, but alive. Jesus appeared to the other disciples, and Thomas put his fingers in Jesus' wounds. Jesus was present with them again. Hope sprung forth when all hope had seemed gone. There was good news and life where death had previously been. Jesus, both fully divine and fully human, overcame the power of death and was among them physically again. Jesus stayed with them for 40 days after the resurrection and then ascended into heaven. Just as when Jesus had been crucified, and in the midst of their grief and loss, the disciples pondered, "What now? How do we move forward? What is next for us?" I wonder if these questions were top of mind after Jesus had ascended as well. The one whom they'd followed. They'd walked in his footsteps, heard his voice, received Jesus' healing touch. He was no longer with them. But Jesus' last words before ascending into heaven were, "You will receive the power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." Jesus does not leave them empty-handed. Jesus promises them that they will receive the power of the Holy Spirit. This same Holy Spirit, breath of God, wind and energy that moved over the waters at creation and brought forth new life. The same Holy Spirit that equipped the prophets to speak God's call to justice and faithfulness to people throughout the ages. And the same Spirit that descended on Jesus at his baptism. Jesus proclaims to his followers that the Holy Spirit will come upon them too. While Jesus will not physically be with them anymore, they are not left without comfort and guidance. In our reading today from Acts, over 100 of Jesus' followers are gathered together when a wind from heaven fills the entire house. Acts recounts that all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. They were gathered in Jerusalem, a bustling city filled with people from many different places, speaking many different languages. The disciples start speaking about God's power and the people in the city, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes and Cretans and Arabs. They all hear the disciples preaching the gospel in their own language. The good news of God in Christ Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit is for all people in all places. There is no language or location or demographic of people that God's love and grace do not extend to. New life and forgiveness of sin by the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus are for everyone. It is the Holy Spirit that equipped these first disciples to witness to God's power and has empowered followers of Jesus throughout time and space. One of our ancestors in faith, Martin Luther, in the early 1500s, translated the Bible from Hebrew and ancient Greek into German. At this time, most Bibles were written in Latin, and it was mostly priests and scholars who could read and interpret scripture. Martin Luther translated the Bible into the German language so that the people in his community and country could read and interpret scripture themselves. Others had translated the Bible into other languages before Martin Luther, but he happened to do his translation work at a time when the printing press was just getting going. This made the production of books much faster. Literacy in Germany was growing, and coupled with the printing press's ability to make so many books, the Bible, written in German, quickly became a bestseller, and people were able to read God's word for themselves in their own language. Before Martin Luther and to this day, the Bible continues to be translated into more languages so that people in all places are able to read and hear and discuss the stories of God's faithfulness for themselves and their communities. We continue to see evidence of the Holy Spirit at work in the body of Christ. Last week, I watched the ecumenical memorial service for lives lost to COVID from the National Council of Churches, and it's available on YouTube if you want to watch it. In this service, pastors and leaders from the Greek Orthodox Church, the ELCA, Episcopal Disciples of Christ, Reformed Church of America, the Conference of National Black Churches, the African Methodist Episcopal Church, African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, American Baptist Church, Presbyterian, United Church of Christ, Armenian Orthodox Church of Christ, and the Christian Methodist Episcopal Church gathered for worship. And this service included prayers and scripture readings in Korean, French, Navajo, and English. These faith leaders came together to mourn the deaths caused by COVID-19 and to pray for God's healing in our world. While these leaders represent many different denominations with different traditions, we are the body of Christ together, empowered and equipped by the Holy Spirit to pray for and work for justice and healing in the world. Just as Jesus did not leave the first disciples empty-handed when he ascended into heaven and his physical presence was no longer with them, you are not left comfortless either. You are never separated from God. The Holy Spirit dwells within you. In the beginning, the breath of God moved over the water and brought all things into being. The Spirit remains active today, bringing new life among and in us. The Spirit equips and empowers and goes with you always.
Join me as we profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I'm Pastor Meg Halverston of Middle Coon Valley. And for our prayers today on this Pentecost Sunday, we are recognizing that the Spirit blows not just here in the valleys and ridges of the Crosse Area Synod, but throughout God's entire world. So we are going to lift up some of the countries and different parts of the world and pray for their specific needs. And I invite you to participate in this prayer by standing up. And I'm going to invite you to have your body face the direction for which we are praying. This prayer was first written by the people of the South, and it was shared at one of our Senate assemblies, so I have tweaked it slightly for today. So please rise and face the East. Some of the countries of the East include mainland China, Mongolia, North Korea and South Korea, Taiwan, Cambodia, Laos, the Philippines, Thailand, Singapore, and West Asia. Let us pray. We pray for the people in the South who live in poverty and have limited choices. Many of them are migrant workers living and working in a foreign land. They may be lonely, have limited access to resources, are separated from their family and loved ones. Oh Lord, give them strength, courage, love, peace, and perseverance to face the everyday challenges. May they know your presence and love. We pray they can be reunited with their families and that they have a better life in the future. I now invite you to turn your body and face the north. Included in the region of the North, not only Minnesota and Canada, but all of North America and parts of Russia, often areas that we consider having more privilege. We pray for the North, for the northern migrating herds of caribou and pods of whales, for polar bears, seals, and reindeer, for northern birds that migrate from farthest north to deepest south. We pray, O Lord, for the people of the North across Siberia, for those of the First Nations of Canada who have lived in and cared for the land and its creatures. We pray for those who have much but are often haunted by problems, issues, and health in the midst of abundance. We pray for those who struggle for work and meaning and all who seek you. I now invite you to turn your body and face the West, which in where I am standing is Chaseburg and the Mississippi. As we imagine countries of the West, Northern Africa, Greece, and the Middle East, we pray for the peoples of the West, for the land, for the devastation as people struggle to survive, for an end to violence and corrupt government, for needed water and food to reach its people, and for uncertain economic struggles to end. We pray for the Middle East, and especially the land of Israel and Palestine, for the ongoing conflict over this holy land, its residents, and hurting people. O Lord, bring peace and justice. Protect, guide, and illuminate your people. And finally, I invite you to face the South. Some of the countries considered South include Southern Africa and Latin America. We pray for the people of the South. Oh Lord, we thank you for the abundance of human and natural resources, for the wonderful diversity of peoples and landscapes. Yet, Lord, despite the richness of their resources, they remain poor and without vision. The landscape is characterized by the brutal scars of exploitation and corrupt government. Oh, Lord, we pray for the southern regions, for the sufferings and pain, sickness and grief, that it will end. We pray for the establishment of peace in warring countries, for reconstruction and development work, and for the miracles of our time. We thank you for all those who work and minister on our behalf, who help to alleviate the suffering of others. We also pray for our faith communities in the South Conference of the Crosse Area Synod, for Westby, Lafarge, Ontario, Coon Valley, DeSoto, Rockland, Ferryville, Viroqua, Cashton, Soldiers Grove, Gays Mills, Chaseburg, Mount Sterling, Reedstown, Wazika, and Prairie du Chien. May the Spirit guide, direct us and all your people in our communities in and throughout your world. May your Spirit blow. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
This reflection was shared by Pastor Stacy Naylene Carlson, and I share it with you today. She begins with verses from the 8th chapter of the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus lays his hands on the eyes of a man to restore his sight. And at first he says, "I can see people, but they look like trees walking." This is the man's response when Jesus asks him, "Can you see anything?" Jesus has begun his healing work. He has put saliva on the man's eyes and lays his hands on him, but the healing isn't complete. "I can see people, but they look like trees walking." And she writes, "I wonder for myself, how often can I see people, but they look like something less than fully human? They look like something to be feared. They look like a threat. How often can I see people, but they look like a problem to be solved or a cause to stand up for, an injustice to be righted? How often can I see people but not really see them at all, because I can't see past the ingrained, entrenched, saturated all things racism that courses through me? How often can I see people but not really see them at all, because I can't see past the posts they shared on Facebook that I deem so offensive, or the joke they told, or the candidate they voted for? The man can't yet see people for who they really are, and he admits this. He answers honestly when Jesus asks him if he can see. He wants to see people as people, not as trees walking. So Jesus lays his hands on the man's eyes again. Jesus continues the healing work he began. And now the man sees everything clearly. I pray today that we can all answer honestly when Jesus asks us if we can see. And if we can't yet see clearly, if we can't see people as people, then I hope we can beg Jesus to keep on working healing in our lives and in the life of this world. It's past time to see clearly. Christ, have mercy. Amen. Lord God, be with us. Help, guide, and protect the people of Minneapolis and St. Paul. Help our nation. Help us to examine ourselves. Comfort those of us who grieve and those who are angry. We do not pray for vengeance, but Lord, we do thirst for justice. In the name of the one who came that we might have life, and life more abundantly, we pray. Amen. Lord God, mystery, creator, first breath, we cannot go on this way, with broken bones and unhealed wounds and people screaming in the streets for air. We are trying not to give up on each other. We need to remember our way home. We need to learn to believe in us. Help us remember what it means. Help us name and honor those who are killed in our streets. Help us name our white supremacy. Help us hold one another in real love. Help us decenter hate. Help us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Padre nuestro, que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre. Venga a nosotros tu reino. Hágase, Señor, tu voluntad en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día. Perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en la tentación y líbranos del mal. Amén.
Let us pray. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need. Awaken us to the needs of others. And at the end, bring all the world to your feast. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Peace be with you. Come, Holy Spirit. It is a joy to be able to worship with you this morning. I'm Pastor Libby Howe. I'm the assistant to the bishop in the La Crosse Area Synod. And as a word of encouragement during the offering today in worship, I just want to say thank you for the ways that you have been and will continue to be generous with your money, with your prayers, with your whole selves. When we celebrate the offering in worship, it's a way of responding to the great love that God has for us. In fact, it's even a way of testifying to the great deeds of power that God has done in our own lives, that we want to continue to share that with other people. I see that in our campus ministry. I see it in the ways that our pastors have responded to this pandemic. I see it in the ways that you have been supportive of one another and are using this time to learn and to grow in faith and in love. God is doing a big new thing right now with us, and I am so excited to be a part of that with you. Thank you for all that you give, for your prayers, and for your witness to the Holy Spirit.
Receive God's blessing. In our moments of chaos, God is with us. In our moments of calm, God is with us. In our moments of life, God is with us. Hallelujah. We go as a Pentecost people, touched by fire, stirred by wind, to mend the world. Hallelujah.
Summoned by the God who made us rich in our diversity, gathered in the name of Jesus, richer still in unity. Let us bring the gifts that differ and his land in very ways. Sing a new church into being, one in faith and love and radiant, risen from the water, robed in holiness and light, male and female in God's image, male and female God's delight. Let us bring the gifts that differ and expand in very ways. Sing a new church into being, one in faith and love and praise. Trust the goodness of creation, trust the Spirit strong within. Dare to dream a vision promise, sprung from seed of what has been. Let us bring the gifts that differ and expand in very ways. Sing a new church into being, one in faith and love and song of peace and justice, let it sound through time and space. Let us bring the gifts that differ and expand in very ways. Sing a new church and new being, one in faith and love and praise. Draw together at one table all the circle ever wider,